welcome to the Daily Roundup. I am Sumedha.
And I'm Prashant. And here are the major stories for the day.
A three-year-old has been allegedly raped in Bandipora and massive protests have started in the valley. Thousands have also taken to the streets in Odisha as the government fails to restore essential utilities like electricity and water. A Dalit wedding has come in the line of fire in Gujarat, and multiple attacks have taken place in the past week. Civilian groups in Sudan have bridged the differences over plans for how the country will move forward, and there are tensions in the Persian Gulf region after alleged sabotage of the Saudi tankers. For our top story of the day, we are taking you to Kashmir, and the state of Jammu and Kashmir is witnessing turbulence and multiple protests in the valley after a three-year-old was allegedly raped by a youth in Tregam region of the Bandipora district. There are multiple protests which have started, and the police has also arrested the accused after the complaint by the family. And we had our correspondent Kamran Yusuf present on the ground giving us all the details of the case and the ongoing protests in the valley. Take a look at his report.
साला बच्ची के साथ ऐसी घिनौनी हरकत ये है
हम जस्टिस चाहते हैं हमारा मतलब कुछ नहीं है क्योंकि मैं जो है कोई 3 साल की बच्ची थी जब उसके साथ आज ये हुआ ऐसी घिनौनी हरकत हो गई ये सोचने वाली बात है कि कल वो हमारे साथ क्या
देखिए जैसे ही ये इंसिडेंट हमारे नोटिस में आया सबसे पहले मैं कहूंगा कि ये बेहद दर्दनाक जो है हादसा है और इमीडिएटली हमने इसमें कार्रवाई करते हुए जो है एक्यूज्ड को अरेस्ट किया और हमने इमीडिएटली जो बच्ची है उसको इमीडिएटली बेस्ट से बेस्ट मेडिकल फैसिलिटीज जो है उसको अवेलेबल कराई और अभी इसमें इन्वेस्टिगेशन अंडर प्रोसेस है और हमने इसमें हीनियस सेक्शंस जो भी स्पेशल एक्ट के तहत पोस्को के तहत हमने पोस्को जो एक्ट है उसको इन्वोक किया है जिसमें जो है ज़्यादा से ज़्यादा सजा का प्रावधान है
हम पीछे नहीं बैठेंगे जब तक इस छोटी सी बच्ची को इंसाफ मिले और हमारा मकसद यही है कि इसको फास्ट ट्रैक पर बुनियादों पर इस पर कार्रवाई हो जाए और इस पर हमारे जो एडमिनिस्ट्रेशन बांडीपुरा हमें पूरा भरोसा है यहाँ के पुलिस पर हम अभी खामोश बैठे हैं जब तक एडमिनिस्ट्रेशन कोई कदम ना उठाए एडमिनिस्ट्रेशन अपना काम कर रही है उसके बाद अगर हमें लगेगा कि इसको इंसाफ नहीं मिला तो हम सारी हदें पार करके हम पूरे एक जुटकर यहाँ के यूथ हम पूरे धरना पे बैठेंगे हम भूख हड़ताल पे बैठेंगे
On the Daily Roundup, we've been extensively following the kind of relief measures that have been taken by the Odisha government to ensure that the impact of the Cyclone Fani is limited in the state. We've been following the kind of relief that was being provided to the people. In the latest development, a week after the aftermath of Cyclone Fani, about 1.5 crore people who are affected in the state are still struggling as the state government is trying its best to restore the kind of electricity and other essential services that are needed by the people. However, residents of the parts of states like Bhubaneswar and Puri are still struggling for basic services like electricity, and members and residents of the districts which were affected by the cyclone have now taken to protests in the state to urge the Odisha government to act swiftly and to restore electricity in the sweltering heat. While the state government claimed to have restored power and drinking water supplies in urban pockets of Kendrapara and Cuttack districts, people on Saturday blocked roads connecting Pradeep and Cuttack and the national highway linking Bhubaneswar with Puri. They said that basic amenities had still not been provided and there were reports that Dalits were being discriminated against in the relief distribution. Debatra Patra of the Action Aid, who had visited Kana's block on Friday, said that about 100 odd Dalit families in the area were not given any relief as upper caste people drove them away. He quoted and I state that the Dalit families had moved to cyclone shelters, but they were made to sit in one corner of the shelter and had food separately. Now that they are being discriminated, while food and polythene sheets are being distributed. We're now moving to our third story, which is from Gujarat, which again focuses on the kind of caste lines that become more evident in the times that we're living in India. So when we look at Gujarat, there have been Dalit processions of weddings and other processions that are being disrupted. So there are multiple reports that are surfacing from different areas of Gujarat. And more recently, a Dalit wedding procession was also disrupted. And this was in the Aravali region of the state. We had our correspondent Damayanti Dhar present on the ground to understand what is happening and to understand the gravity of the situation. Take a look at her ground report.
Four incidents of people of upper caste interrupting and attacking marriage procession of Dalit couples have happened in about a week's time in North Gujarat. On May 9, Sanjay Rathore, a Dalit police constable from Boria village in Sabarkantha, faced objection for upper caste while taking out his marriage procession and then had to sought to police protection. On the same day, Mehul Parmar of Lohr village in Mehsana faced objection and then later social boycott for riding a horse in his marriage procession. Later, two incidents occurred on May 12, in one case where members of Thakur community objected to groom riding horse and then offering prayers at local temple. Later, the marriage procession was taken out under police protection. In another incident on the same day in Khambisar village in Arvali district, members of Patidar or Patel community organized bhajan and yagna on the main road to block Dalit marriage procession and later stone pelted on the family. The local police then had to resort to lathi charge to control the situation. Several people are reported to be injured in this incident.
Moving on to our international section, tensions are rising in the Persian Gulf region after the sabotage of two Saudi tankers. To discuss more about this, we have Abdul.
So Abdul, we've seen a sabotage of Saudi tankers of the UAE coast over the past couple of days. And the US has also been quick to release a statement, a vague statement almost, saying that Iranian forces might be, Iran proxies might be sabotaging traffic in the Persian Gulf. So how do you see the situation panning out, especially with the recent incident and the US forces, of course, coming to the region?
Shan, we don't exactly know whether this is a sabotage or an accident.
It
might be an accident.
Right.
So we don't know. But given the tension in the region, primarily the sanctions, post-sanctions, the Iranian threat to block the Strait of Hormuz.
Right.
And in that context, the US is deploying USS Abraham
Lincoln,
in the region.
Right.
So given that particular context and given the tension between Iran and the regional players, Saudi Arabia and UAE, it can be used for different purposes, primarily to target Iran, that Iran is behind it. So it can lead to that. It might not, but we don't know. Exactly how it will turn out, but given the statements which are coming out, for example, primarily after the Lebanese and the Iranian TV channels reported it first, basically that is used by the UAE and other people to subtly put the point that Iran is behind
responsible
it,
for
or that. Iran or the proxies are behind it.
Right.
So that is what we don't know how it will turn out.
Exactly, and I think the Iranian government has also expressed concern that this might be the strategy that you deploy military forces and then an accident takes place.
Exactly.
Right.
Yeah. Even though their ministers have come out with a statement that there might be a misuse of this particular incident.
Okay.
In fact, they were the first to raise the concern
that
this incident can be used against it. So that is playing in the larger geopolitics game in the region.
Exactly.
It can be used.
What do you see as Iran's best solution to this situation right now, considering that it's almost encircled by these kind of forces?
The Iranians can only clarify. If there is an attempt to blame them, they can come out with the clear statement that they are ready for all kind of investigation. And I think they will be doing that because they do not want to escalate the situation in that way. It is not in their interest.
Right.
In our second story, we take you to Sudan, where certain rifts among the civilian forces over the future of the country seem to have been resolved. The Declaration of Freedom and Change Forces, the umbrella organization, which comprises the Sudanese Professional Association and many other parties, had developed disagreements over the role of the military in the government. While one section of the DCFC was fine with relatively greater military involvement, the Sudanese Professional Association and the Sudanese Communist Party were very clear that the role of the civilians had to be paramount in the new structure. These developments came after the army was forced to step in on April 11th to remove Omar al-Bashir from the role of president. The army was forced to step in after protests that began in December, and protesters had begun to mobilize in front of the army headquarters in Khartoum demanding a solution. Ever since, this stalemate has continued, and over the past 1 week, the army actually used force against protesters at various points of time. They also attempted to dismantle many of the barricades that the protesters had set up. But the protesters refused to back down and instead began mobilizing in front of army headquarters in many other cities in addition to Khartoum. It is amidst all this that the disagreements developed within the DCFC. One section of the DCFC, led by the Sudanese Professionals Association and the Communist Party, wanted just one council which is dominated by civilians. On the other hand, a certain set of parties recommended two councils, one of which would be civilian dominated but led by a military general, and the other which would be completely dominated by the military. The second council, according to this new proposal, would have the right to decide on matters of war and peace as well as the army. The Sudanese Professionals Association and the Communist Party were very unhappy with this proposal, as this meant that the army and defense and other matters would remain under the control of the military dispensation. The Sudanese army has an important role to play in the war in Yemen, which is led by the United Arab Emirates and Saudi Arabia. Similarly, it also cracks down on migration considerably, as per instructions issued by the European Union. There have also been a lot of concerns addressed that as long as the military has a dominant role, the possibility of negotiating with rebel groups for a final peace in Sudan is impossible. That's all we have in the international section.
And that's all that we have for you today on this episode of the Daily Roundup. To follow these stories and many more, log on to our website www.newsclick.in, subscribe to our channel on YouTube, and follow us on Facebook. Thank you for watching.